Exodus 8.
Amen.
Exodus 8.
Just waiting for one.
Exodus chapter 8.
Like I said, it's good to be saved knowing you're not going to hell. Jesus Christ, he died on the cross. He was buried. He rose again the third day, if you just believe on that. Amen. Trust on the blood of Jesus Christ, forgiveness of sins. Want to help you out today. If you're holding anything back from the Lord, you can pray about that while we're praying. Pray about that. You want the full blessing of God's message. The full blessing of God's message. Exodus chapter 8, I'm going to do the first 10 verses. The first 10 verses in Exodus chapter 8. The Bible says, And the Lord spake unto Moses, go unto Pharaoh and say unto him, thus saith the Lord, let my people go that they may serve me. And if thou refuse to let them go, behold, I will smite all thy borders with frogs, and the river shall bring forth frogs abundantly, which shall go up and come into thine house, and into thy bedchamber, and upon thy bed, and into the house of thy servants, and upon thy people, and into thine ovens, and into thy kneading troughs. And the frogs shall come up both on thee, and upon thy people, and upon all thy servants. And the Lord spake unto Moses, say unto Aaron, stretch forth thine hand with thy rod over the streams, over the rivers, and over the ponds, and cause frogs to come upon the land of Egypt. And Aaron stretched out his hand over the waters of Egypt, and the frogs came up and covered the land of Egypt. And the magicians did so with their enchantments, and brought up frogs upon the land of Egypt. Then Pharaoh called for Moses and Aaron, and said, entreat the Lord that he may take away the frogs from me and from my people, and I will let the people go, that they may do sacrifice unto the Lord. And Moses said unto Pharaoh, glory over me. When shall I entreat for thee, and for thy servants, and for thy people, to destroy the frogs from thee and thy houses, and they may remain in the river only? And he said, tomorrow. He said, tomorrow. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for this word of God. I thank you, Lord, for Jesus Christ. I thank you, Lord, for a Savior that did something for us, Lord God. You're a God who sent your Son to die for us. Where there's other religions that they think we should send our sons to die for their God. We got a gracious Lord. We got a Lord that pities us. We got a Lord that loves us when we're unlovable, forgives us when we're unforgivable. Lord, this isn't about a preacher or a person. This is about the Lord Jesus Christ. This is about you, Lord. We want you lifted up, you edified, and let us be abased, put down a little, Lord, and be humbled a little today, Lord God. Let's talk about Christ being crucified in the end and all about him. Lord, anoint the area of fresh oil. Give somebody a new right spirit when they walk out of here. Maybe break their heart a little so you can mend it. We love you, Lord, and just want to serve you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. So, the Bible says that there was plagues, and we know that that God sent plagues upon Egypt. He said, let my people go, and he wanted to bring the Israelites out of the land of Egypt. They've been there for 400 years, basically about 430 years in the end. And God turns around, he says, it's time. He gets Moses together, gets him down there. And the first plague went out. And of course, we know, if anybody's ever watched even the movie, the first public plague that he puts on them, and the first miracle, he turns around, he turns around, makes the rivers to what? To blood, right? He makes the rivers to blood. And this one right here, it's the second plague. And what he does right here is he puts frogs. Frogs come up. He touches the ground, the riverbed or whatever, or calls them up, and God brings up frogs in the land. This is the second plague. You got to understand, the river's already stinking. The river already stinks. There is already blood. Fish have died. There's dead fish. There's slime all over the place. And Pharaoh, it says in the Bible, it says he doesn't even go bathe there anymore. He doesn't go in the Nile. So he was using that Nile to bathe at that time. You see, one of the things you have to understand about Egypt is that Nile River was everything to Egypt. If you want to know anything about history, how that Pharaoh became in control was knowing that the irrigation of the land, there are certain days of the year, a certain time frame, when the Nile River gets overflown, goes up, and it irrigates the land. And Pharaoh knew, the Pharaohs, they knew when that time was, so they became a very powerful individual by knowing some knowledge. And Pharaoh, we know, is a picture of who? He's a picture of the devil, right? The Antichrist, the devil. And we also know that Egypt is a picture of what? The world, right? It's a picture of the world, okay? Egypt's being a picture of the world, and he's a picture of the devil, and he's in charge right now, okay? They went down there under Joseph to survive through famine, and Israel has survived. Now God's calling his people out of there, okay? Now, the way I could see this going a little bit is, you got to think about it. Here you got Moses and Aaron, and they do the one plague. They turn around and go down there, and they start with that one plague, which is, the rivers turning to blood. And I guess when they first walked in, you got to understand, this is just a guy coming out of the desert. Okay? This is the most powerful nation on the earth right now. And you got a guy coming out of the desert, and he walks into Pharaoh and he says, let my people go. Okay? And I can imagine he goes in there and the first time and he says, hey Pharaoh, I'm walking in, I'm dirty and everything else, and I'm not even a diplomat or anything else. See, I got this rod in my hand, and I want you to let my people go. And I can just imagine Pharaoh, like anybody else, like our president would, somebody comes in, starts telling him what to do with no credentials, no diplomacy, nothing under his belt, and I can see it. Think about it. They're just walking in. They're just a bunch of shepherd boys walking in and saying to Pharaoh, let my people go. And I can imagine Pharaoh just sitting there going, oh, yeah, right. Let your people go, right? Like you got something going there. And, here I am and I'm Pharaoh. Now, all of a sudden, I guess things have changed a little. Because at this time, you got Moses and Aaron are coming in, okay? And this is after they just made the rivers to blood, and all the fish are dead, and the whole area is stinking up after they'd say it. Now I get you, after this, they could just probably walk in the place with credentials. I mean, you got to think about it. As time went on through all these plagues, Moses is probably just walking in. Why? There's somebody to be feared. Because now they understood that this man took away part of their economy. I mean, you got to understand, the Nile River is definitely going to have an economy to it. It's definitely going to have fish in that river. They're definitely making money off that fish, plus transportation of things that they need to go down that river. They definitely have something going on with that river. Now they walk in this time. I bet you the guy was like, come on right in. Here comes Moses and Aaron. Now, yeah, there are two guys. Come on, get in here. I don't want to mess around with these guys. I don't want to mess around with these guys. And I would assume they just went over there and they say, the guards are sitting there and there's Pharaoh and he says, oh, you guys again. Oh, you guys again. Because now that they got credentials. And the next thing out of Moses' mouth is probably something like, thus saith the Lord. Or he said it out of from Aaron. He says, thus saith the Lord. And I can imagine Pharaoh just turning around saying, oh boy, here it comes. Oh boy, here it comes. And he says frogs. Frogs? Who would ever think of that? Who would think of frogs? You got to understand something. Now we have the river. The river and the water, he makes blood. That's one item. But guess what? Now we're talking about frogs. We're talking about individuals. Each frog has a mind of its own in some way. And we're talking about frogs coming up. And I can imagine Pharaoh saying, you know, you're bluffing. You got to be bluffing right here. There's no way you're going to be able to pull this one off. He's got to be thinking right there. And all of a sudden Moses turns around, he says, there's going to be frogs. And guess what happens? Up come the frogs. Up come those frogs, and they start covering every place around. They start going everywhere. They're in everything. And you got to understand something. Everything that's happening right now to Egypt, do you realize that everything is also happening to Israel at the same exact time? It's not like the movies. Israel wasn't sitting there having a party. This is still the second plague. Why? Look down at verse number 22. Look down at verse number 22. It wasn't until after that it says, I will sever the land. I will sever the land in the day, in that day, the land of Goshen. And those swarms of flies. It wasn't until the flies came around that he severed the land and they were separated. This is still, they're all under the same thing. Look, the Israel was looking for water. When the Nile went and all the ponds and all the springs went, guess what? They were still looking for water too. It wasn't like they were doing okay and they had everything going. They're looking for water at the same exact time that those Israelites are looking for water. It's not like they got away with something. So they're suffering just like the Egyptians are. So now you got something else going on. And Pharaoh, he calls for Moses in verse number 8. In verse number 8, it says that Pharaoh called for Moses. And he calls for Moses and Aaron. And in verse number 9, look what it says. It says, glory. It says, glory over me. He wants them out of there. He wants them to get rid of those frogs. He's going to let them sacrifice. And you notice what it says. It says, glory over me. So right away, if you were a Bible scholar, you got to get rid of that. Why? You don't understand something. He said, glory over me. Why would Moses turn around and say, glory over me? Well, go back one chapter. Exodus chapter 7. He said, glory over me. When shall I? Why, I ask God for thee. Glory over me. Look at Exodus chapter 7. Look at verse number 1. It says, and the Lord said. So is this going to be a true statement here?
Yep.
The Lord says it. Look what he says. It says, and the Lord said unto Moses, see, I have made thee a what? A God to Pharaoh, and Aaron thy brother shall be thy prophet. He turns around and says, see, I made you God unto him. Now that's the Lord saying. Now I understand that is that's a small g, but that's a pretty big thing to say, isn't it? I mean, I would think that would be a pretty big thing to say. I made you a God unto Pharaoh. That means that you have some power with Pharaoh right there. And I would think Moses does, because considering that how many other people had just made the Nile into blood. How many other people could do something like that? I don't see it happening. It's never happened before. Until the New Testament, things weren't made until Jesus Christ came along. And he made the water into wine. So he calls for Moses and he says, glory over to me. And guess what Moses is to Pharaoh? He's a mediator. He becomes Pharaoh's mediator. And Moses is going to be the man who speaks to God for Pharaoh. And he turns around, he says, Pharaoh says, I need these frogs taken away. You got to understand something, these are in his knee troughs, it said. These things were all over the place, they were in the ovens. You see, they were not just a pestilence inside their bed chambers, like it says right there. You know where it also was? It was in their food. Not just in their in their normal area, common areas. Now it's inside their food. These are a nuisance. And they're also being a nuisance to Israel. At the same exact time, Israel's going through exactly what they're going through. So they're having a tough time of it too. And here he comes, he says, glory over me. And he says, when you want me in, and I'll entreat the Lord. He says, and when do you want me to get rid of these things? Now, ponder that question a little bit. Has anybody here ever had any trouble in their life or a pain or something that just bothered them? And you want it gone right away, don't you? I mean, it's not like you're standing there saying, I got a thorn in my side. I got a tack. I sat on this tack and I want it gone. You don't turn around and think of it and you say, well, I want it gone now, you say. It's not like you want it gone later. You want it gone right there. Now, what does Pharaoh turn around and say in that 10th verse? He turns around and he says, tomorrow. When do you want me to get rid of them frogs? And Pharaoh says, tomorrow. Now that kind of catches you pretty simple there. You know why? Because what Pharaoh's asking for is one more night with the frogs. Now I preached this message before, but it's a different swing to it. But that's what Pharaoh is actually asking for. He's saying, when do you want me to get rid of the frogs? He says, well, I want one more night with them. I want one more night with the smell, is basically what he's saying. I want one more night with dealing with this mess that I've created. And that's basically what Pharaoh's saying to Moses, is I want one more night with these frogs. Let me give you a classic example of things that I've seen in my life. I've seen people turn around and I've been witness to them. And I'll say to them, well, did you ever think about the Lord Jesus Christ? They say, well, yeah, I have thought about him. Well, did you ever think about getting saved? And they turn around and they'll say, well, yeah, I have. I just thought of it right now. Do you believe that Christ died for your sins? And they say, yeah, I believe that. They believe that. They say, I believe that. And then they turn around and they'll say, you'd like to have a relationship with the Lord, would you not? And they say, well, yeah, I'd like that. And you say, yeah, okay. You believe that you're a sinner. And they say, yeah, you believe you need a Savior. And they say, oh yes, I believe that. And you say, okay, why don't you get saved? And they say, well, I'm too tired right now. You know you're going to hell. Yes, I do know that. And you know that if you don't accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you'll wind up in hell, don't you? And they say, well, yes, I understand that. Would you get saved? I'm just too tired right now, preacher. I'm just too tired right now. You know what they're actually saying? No. They're actually saying no. They want one more night. They'll say, well, you know, come, I'm going to do that tomorrow. You know, just leave that stuff there. And I understand everything you're saying, preacher. And I actually believe everything you're saying. But I just don't want to. I'm just tired right now. I'll read that stuff tomorrow, is what they're saying to me. And know what they're asking for? One more night of sin. They're asking for one more night of sin. They're saying to you that they'd like to have at least one more night dealing with the smell of sin in their life, is what they're asking you that they want. One more night with the frogs is what they're asking for. I mean, the frogs, by this time, I don't know any of you, but I live on a road that has a swamp. And on that road that has a swamp, during about September time frame, when the dew comes up at nighttime, when all that weather comes up, we go down our road, and know what happens when there's a little bit of rain? We hear crack, 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 crack. And what that crack, crack, crack is a whole bunch of frogs that are jumping at our headlights, and we're just demolishing them as we drive up our road. Okay, we just hear them snapping, and really, to tell you the truth, I'm not a frog killer or anything like that, but I can tell you it is a little bit funny to hear that stuff go on, because they're jumping at the headlights of the car, but yet they're still getting killed and cracked all over the place, and it is kind of a little hilarious. But what you have there after it's done is you have a smell. You have a smell from those frogs, and that smell kind of lasts for a while through the summertime, through that last part of September, of course, until it gets cold, and then it basically goes away. But that smell is pretty intense, and what Pharaoh's asking for is one more night with the frogs. What a person that's unsaved is asking for is one more night. Now, I dealt with this woman just down the road right here, and I said to her, I said, would you like to get saved? And she said, yes, I would like to get saved. I said, why don't you do it right now? She turned around to me, and she said, well, I'm kind of tired right now. I said, well, it's not something that's going to take any energy from you. Why don't you just bow your head and maybe ask the Lord to save you? She turned around, and she said, I can't right now. I'm too tired. I said, what do you mean you're too tired? She said, I've had cancer for a while, and that cancer has made me tired. I said, okay. I said, do you want me to come back tomorrow? She said, no, I'll just leave that. Just leave me some of that literature, and I'll do it tomorrow. Okay? So all of a sudden, somebody pulled up, and that person that pulled up said her name, and then turned around and said, hey, are you ready to go to casinos? And all of a sudden, the woman was like doing jumping jacks. she was like, yeah, oh, I got to get going, I got to get ready, I thought you were too tired. You know what the thing was? She liked one more night in that sin. She wanted one more night dealing with the sin in her life. She figured that if she would get saved, she'd have to change a little bit of that life. You know what she's really asking for? One more night with the frogs is what she's asking for. She's asking that maybe she could have one more night with the filth of her life is what she's asking for. You know, preacher, you don't understand, preacher, if I could just have one more night. Just one more night in my filth. I mean, I've led bartenders to Christ. I've led some of them that have turned around in the first bit. And I've actually laughed with them where they turned around and said they didn't want to get saved because they'd lose their job as a bartender. I've had some that have turned around to me and said, well, if I'm going to lose my job, just give me one more night so I can pay my bills. And guess what? What happens is that tomorrow comes that they said they do it, and guess what they don't do? They don't get saved. They don't get saved. I would bet you that hell is a place that it echoes the word tomorrow. I would assume that hell is a place that if you were to go down there, you would hear the words tomorrow. Tomorrow, tomorrow. You know why tomorrow's a bad time? Because tomorrow never comes. You said, what do you mean? Tomorrow we're going to be doing this. No, because when it becomes the next day, it's today. You see, they like to spend one more day, one more night with those frogs. You know what the Lord said? Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 6. 2 Corinthians chapter 6. Second Corinthians chapter 6. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, you know what? It says, "For he saith, I have heard thee in a time accepted, and in the day of salvation have I succored thee. Behold," what? "Now." Now is the accepted time in chapter 6, verse number 2. He says, "Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of salvation." You know why when you get saved, you know what you didn't do? You didn't say tomorrow. You realize that there's an impact on the word tomorrow. Like I said, hell is a place that's probably littered right now with a whole bunch of people down there yelling, "I should have never said tomorrow. I should have never said tomorrow. I should have listened to that preacher and never said the words tomorrow. I wish that word would have never come out of my mouth, that word tomorrow." Hell's a place littered with that. One word, tomorrow. I could imagine people that are go through the judgment with God and the great white throne standing in front of them, and when he starts to show them how many times a tract was put to them, how many times the gospel was put to them, how many times they had the chance, and somebody turned around and said, "You don't understand the loveliness of one verse. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever shall believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life." Would you like to get saved? "No, preacher, tomorrow. You know, I'll get saved tomorrow. You just don't realize I have an event today. I have a family that I need to deal with today. And preacher, I'm going to get saved, but it's just going to be tomorrow." And there God shows them right in their face that tomorrow never came. Hell is a place littered with the word tomorrow. And tomorrow has never come. Because when tomorrow comes, today was yesterday. And tomorrow is still the next day. That was a place that is littered with the word tomorrow. Well, go to Luke chapter 12. I have relatives, and I've said to them, "Would you like to get saved?" They said, "Yes, I believe I'm a sinner. I need to get saved." I said, "Well, okay, you need to get saved. Let's do it right now." "Well, how about if we do it tomorrow? I just got a lot to do today." That was a place that's littered with the sounds of tomorrow, tomorrow. Look at verse number 16. Luke chapter 12, verse number 16. And it says, "And he spake a parable unto them, saying, The ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentiful. And he thought within himself, saying, Shall I do, because I have no room where to bestow my fruits? And he said, This will I do. I will pull down my barns and build greater." He's worried about what's there in front of him. And he says, "And there will I bestow all my fruits and my goods." You notice that "my's" there? "I am my." And he says, "And I will say to my soul," soul, he's talking to his soul, "Soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease, eat, drink, and be merry." Look at verse number 20. "But God said unto him," what? "Thou fool. This night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then whose shall those things be which thou hast provided?" Man goes into the Lord, and the Lord turns around and shows him so many things. And they turn around and they say, "I don't need you right now, Lord. I'd rather have one more night with those frogs. You know, Lord, I know you're God, and I know I need this stuff, but I'd just like to have one more night with those frogs. I just want one more night with my sin." I have relatives that have money. And that money that they have, they said it means the world to them. And you say to them, you know, "That money is not going to buy anything in where God is." And you know what they say? "Well, it's got something to me now. It's got something to me now." And they turn around and they profane God with it. He says, "Look forward to things Look for the things above. And you know what they say? Tomorrow. They say tomorrow. I mean, I know people that get so bad with it, that profane God so bad and won't get saved, won't get right with the Lord, and then all of a sudden, they don't realize, they can't see it because they've gotten so caught up with the world, they don't even realize that most of their kids are unsaved. I mean, they say they're born again and watch their families go to hell. Well, you see, you got to understand something, preacher. Everybody should have their choice. Well, let me ask you something. Are you giving them a choice? Or are you just turning around and you're just saying, whoopee-doo, one more night with the frogs is okay with me, it's okay with you. That's a good rhyme, isn't it? One more night with the frogs, one more night with the frogs. You know, I can just deal with another night with these frogs that are in front of me. The stink is pretty good from down here. You just don't understand, preacher. I just like to deal with that stink all the time. I mean, glad for me I got saved, but let my family go to hell and I won't worry about them. You know, the judgment seat of Christ, it may be sitting with some people that actually remember and say, tomorrow was a bad word. Tomorrow was a bad word. Maybe I shouldn't have put down that I wanted one more night with those frogs. You know, I should have thought for my own people and shouldn't have looked that I wanted just another night with that filth and that smell. And thought maybe I needed the Lord Jesus Christ. Maybe I needed to get right with Him. Maybe I just needed to have a night with the Lord instead of one more night with the filth of the frogs. I think the judgment seat of Christ is going to be filled with people that just see the word tomorrow and it just will disdain them because they have to think on what they said to their own kids in tomorrow. You know, there was a great Frederick the Great. You remember a guy named Frederick the Great. He was a conqueror out of Germany. He said, they put it in the, you ever see the movie Patton? He says, Ladas, Ladas, tout le jour, Ladas. With audacity, he says to him, he says, do it now. Audacity, audacity, charge with audacity, and do it today. When the battle presents itself, you fight then. When it's right there in front of you sometimes. Lodas, do it now. Do that fight right now. Why? Because what you're doing sometimes in your life is you're just staying with one more night with those frogs. I mean, and don't think that you aren't acceptable to this. I mean, think about some of the sins in your lives that you know about, that you're clinging to. I mean, some of us can be pathetic liars and storytellers. And although we know it, we don't give it up. You know what? Don't think you're not susceptible to it. You're just dealing with one more night with the frogs also. You're just doing it in a different way. You're just doing it in a different way. It's one more night with the frogs with you too. Just one more night I need. Is one more night with the frogs. I just want to stay in my sin over here. You know, tomorrow just robs. It robs heaven of precious jewels because you want one more night. How about that habitual sin you got? Let's go to Proverbs chapter 27. Just a simple preaching today. Just a simple preaching today. Proverbs chapter 27. And look at verse number 1. That verse says what? Boast not thyself of tomorrow, for thou knowest not what a day may bring forth. You don't know what tomorrow is going to bring. I mean, you're not guaranteed tomorrow. You say it all the time. You say, nobody's guaranteed tomorrow. The Bible makes you understand something, that death is sure. Sooner or later, every single one of you, if God tarries, you're going to die. You're going to die. Do you know that that's one of the best things that you can say to a person? You say, what? Someday you're going to die. That's a reality. You all believe that, right? In Hebrews it says, and it says it just like this, and science proves it. It says, man is once, it is appointed unto man once to die, and after this the judgment. Now let me give you something there. Number one, it tells you you're going to die. Someday you're going to die. You know what else it told you there? And every religion teaches it. Someday you're going to be judged. Someday you're going to give an account for God for your life. That's what that's saying. Somehow or another, every single person that's out there is going to give an account for their life. Now, I'm going to give you something. I just gave you right there half of a witness. I'll teach you how to witness real fast to somebody. That right there is one verse. Now go to 1 Peter chapter 3. The world looks and it says, I just want one more night, preacher. Just one more night with them frogs. I like this smell. I like it down here. I like one more night, my habitual sin. I like one more night. I like one more night with what I have here, preacher. Everything all messed up. I just want one more night with all that stuff. In 1 Peter chapter 3, in verse go down to verse number 18. It's appointed unto man once to die, and after this to judgment. Look, verse 18. It says, for Christ also hath once suffered for sins. Christ died on the cross, right? He had once suffered for sins. Not a person out there doesn't know that story, that Christ died on the cross. It says for sins. Now look at the next part. It says the just, Brother Perry, right? The just for the unjust. Well, let me ask you a question. Who's the just? Christ is the just. So if Christ is the just, who is the unjust? If a person will answer right there, they are the unjust, and understand that Christ is the just, they are the unjust, and that He died for them, look at that next part. It says that He might bring us to God. Ask the person right there. They're the unjust. He died for them. Would you like to be brought to the Lord? What I gave you right there is only two verses that you can go and witness to and explain that verse and always ask a question and putting them in that position. You are going to die. Yes. You have an appointment with God and you will be judged. Yes. Christ died for you. And sins, yours. Yes, He's the just. You're the unjust. Do you want to be brought to God and be just? If they say yes, they get saved. But you know what usually happens? One more night with the frogs. Well, not right now. You just don't understand. I got this other thing I got to go over here. You know you have your religion. I have mine. You just don't understand how things are, preacher. If I was to get saved, my mom's a Catholic. My father's was a Catholic. And if they have their religion, and I'm going to die just like they did. One more night with these frogs will be fine with me. I like this filth. I like this slime. And I like being down here. That's basically what a person is saying to you when they say they will not get saved. What they are saying to you is, what they want is one more night in the filth, one more night with the disgust, one more night with the filthiness, one more night with the devil. What happened? It got quiet. Why can't you give me an amen? One more night with the devil. Amen, 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 amen. That's what you're looking at. Preacher, I got a habitual sin right here. Can't get rid of it, preacher. I've tried to wean off. Weaning doesn't work. How do you know, preacher, tried that one? You know what? They came up with the word years ago. And it was called what? Cold turkey. Remember that word? Mm-hmm. I looked up that word yesterday. I actually looked it up, and I'll tell you why I looked it up. Because I never could understand why somebody would say the words cold turkey. I never could understand that. I sat there and I said, where did they ever come up with this going cold turkey? Well, then I looked it up and I realized where the expression came from. The expression actually is a modern day phrase, and what it's trying to say is, let's talk turkey. It's telling you to get real. So when somebody turns around and says going cold turkey, what you're trying to say is I want cold turkey, you're trying to say I'm going to get real with this thing. I'm going to get real with this thing. I'm not going to wean it off. You know why? Because when you wean it off, what you're doing is you're laying yourself a trap for one more night with the frogs. One more night with the frogs. You know, I'm having a prayer problem. I'm having a problem getting down on my knees and thinking. You know, I'm having a problem, preacher. I have a problem because when I get down in the morning, all I want to do is sleep in my prayer. Anybody else have that problem? I have. I've had that problem. You know what? You got to get a solution to your problems. And the solution, obviously, isn't what you think. And it's always what God thinks. What are you trying to say? You got to get past the one more night you desire with the frogs. You still desire to stay with the frogs. You have a drinking problem. You have that drinking problem, you need to get rid of it. And guess what? The Bible says you need to separate unto something, not separate from something. The reason why you won't get rid of it is because you like that sin. You want one more night with the frogs. You keep telling stories because you want one more night of telling stories and lying. You keep gossiping and you won't give it up because you like that stuff. You like being in that. You won't give it up. You keep saying you'll give it up tomorrow. Do you realize that everything happens on Monday? You know, I'm going to turn over a new leaf. Monday. Well, you know, starting Monday, I'm going to start the gym. It goes 2 days, and where do you go? You're out of the gym by what? Wednesday? I'm going to start a new diet. That's always been my favorite. People always tell me all the time, I'm going to start a new diet, start this, start that. They're going to cut down, they're going to get to this point. They're going to turn around and get some things done in their life instead of procrastinating. And so they start these diet plans. I'm going to tell you, this is how it works. Just so you know, I'm going to give you it. Don't get upset with me. Okay, it starts out that you start the diet plans, you know, Jenny Craig or whoever, you start that stuff, eating this, don't want to eat this. And then you know what it comes to? It comes around and you turn around and you say, well, I couldn't do that, I'm going to try this. And you're going to keep trying and trying and trying to do this. Turn over a new leaf Monday, turn over a leaf Monday, turn over a leaf Monday. New year comes, turn over a new leaf then. And guess what happens? As it goes down the line, you realize you're failing. So what you do is you turn around and come up with excuse. You know what your excuse is going to be? I got a thyroid problem. I've been through it. I got family. You know what they didn't do? They were relying on themselves to get through losing weight. They were relying on themselves to get into a diet plan. They're relying on doctors to get them into this and get them out of that. You know what they never do? Never got down and asked the Lord, Lord, can you help me lose weight? Lord, I need to do this. What do I need to do? Lord, and start putting your trust in Him and start asking Him. If you want to get out of something and you want to get done with something, the greatest thing that you can ever do is put it over to Him. Do you think He can solve your problem? Yeah. I mean, He's solved every problem in the universe so far. Anybody that could solve the sin problem by... And He does it Himself. He sent His Son. He takes the problem on Himself. Not only does He turn around and create you
and he created you perfect and we messed up, he turns around and brings the cure and gives the cure for us and does it at a free price and turns around and offers it at a free price and says it's a free gift to any man. And you know what man says? I don't want it. What do you want? I want to stay down here with the slime and the filth and the smell. Well, sooner or later, he likened their eternity to what we call a garbage place. He said, look out there at that garbage dump. He goes, there's the eternity. That's what it's like. One more night with the frogs? Is that what you want? You got a bad prayer life, you're having trouble with your prayer life. Why don't you ask God to give you a better prayer life? And trust on him. I'm telling you, he's probably going to put turmoil in your life, but go with it, man. I'd rather be closer to him. If you want people, you know, if you want to be a better witness, ask him. I just gave you two verses. Do you know, I know a man that only uses those two verses, and he's led thousands to the Lord off of two verses, and they're the same exact verses every single time what I just gave you. I read about that this weekend. This is the only two verses this man uses. And he goes in, and when it's not working, he leaves. He goes to the next door, he goes to the next door, he goes to the next person, he goes to the next one. He uses two verses. And he says, if a person doesn't want it or they want it tomorrow, it's just one more night with the frogs. There's got to be somebody out there that doesn't want another night in the filth. How about you? You want another night in the filth? You want another night with the frogs? You like the smell? How about getting something right with God and getting serious with him? He says, get serious. Cold turkey, get serious. Let's talk turkey, God. And let's get serious. You know, you got a God that wants a reason with you. He says, come, let us reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they shall be like crimson, they shall be like wool. You have a God that wants a reason with you. You know what he says all over the Bible, Brother Perry? He says, come. He's just not talking about salvation all the time. He's saying, come on. Let's reason. You got a God that wants a reason with you, wants to talk to you, wants a fellowship with you. But you know what we want? One more night with the frogs. Why don't we pray to him about that today? If you got a problem today, you know, why don't you talk to him today and get it over with and say, Lord, I don't want one more night with the frogs. I want to get out of this mess I'm in. I'm going to trust on you. I'm going to turn that over to you in my life and start looking towards you. Why don't we pray? Father, I thank you, Lord God, for this time. I thank you, Lord God, for the gospel. Jesus Christ died for our sins. He was buried. He rose again. That gives us the power. It's through Jesus Christ that gives us the power not to have that one more night with the frogs. Not to have a destiny in hell. If there's a person out there that needs to get saved, why don't you just ask the Lord today? He's the just. Who are you? You're the unjust. He died for your sins. Why don't you be brought back to God? Why don't you just ask him, Lord, I'm a sinner, and I accept you as my Savior. Say that with your heart. It's not about saying a prayer or tic-tac-toe three in a row. It's not about some set-up prayer. It's just, Lord, remember me. I'm a sinner. And knowing in your heart that Christ suffered and died for you. How about you? You got a problem with sin? You got a sin problem. You got something you're putting before God, an idol, a stubbornness. Maybe you need to give that up, like in a spiritual way. Lord, it's yours. You take it. I don't want to deal with it no more, Lord. You take it. And trusting on him instead of spending one more night with the frogs. Maybe you got some family members that are unsaved and they'd like that one more night with the frogs they got. Maybe just ask him, Lord, please. Lord, I know you made the universe. Why don't you just do something there, Lord God? I don't want my family having one more night with the frogs. I know you're the cure, Lord. Please, Lord, let them know the cure. I'm trusting in you. I don't want one more night with the frogs, Lord God. I have habitual sin in my life at points. I put things ahead. That's idolatry. I don't want that. Father, I thank you for this message. I thank you, Lord God, for the picture displayed, Lord God. I thank you, Lord God, for helping us through many times, separating us unto you, looking towards you. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, amen.